forgiveness, fulfillment, purpose, and submission in Christ. She's the founder of the Doll Ministry, the Daughters of Life and Love. Hallelujah. I know there's some dolls in the house. Yeah, there you go. For many years, she's worked to provide relief from social issues affecting women and children, including hardships, homelessness, and poverty. Her Christian life has been one of consistency and transparency, and each of her many roles offer opportunities for ministry, empowerment, and enhancement for those people she encounters. An unparalleled, candid approach to delivering spiritual wisdom and truth has afforded her the opportunity to speak at conferences and churches across the United States. She was named Woman of the Year by the YWCA. She also received the Community Uplift of the Year Award from Epitome Magazine, and she is honored by National Coalition of 100 Black Women as she received the Torchbearers Award. As an actress, Pastor Friend received rave reviews from the New Orleans Times Picayune and was nominated for the Ambie Award for Excellence in Theater for Best Actress in a Musical Play for her portrayal as Maddie, the lead role in the local production of The Women of Brewster Place. Pastor Friend is married to Bishop Lester Love, has three beautiful daughters, Joy, Faith, and Angel, and I am so grateful to call her Friend. If you will pray for her from your seats, I promise you that the word of God shall go forth with boldness, power, and clarity. If you open your ears and open your arms, open your hearts, you're going to leave here with what God has to say. But before she comes, there is this powerhouse woman that's getting ready to come forth and sing us straight into heaven. She is none other than my sweetheart, the sweetheart of my life, Sister Jonte. I love you, baby. Come on out, guys, to use you to kiss the Lord. Amen.
Wonderful women of God and everybody that's on the Lord's side. Amen. I give honor and glory and praise to the Lord. Amen. Now listen, my sister back here on the organ, when I walked up here, her eyes got this big. So she ain't gonna play with me too much, but we gonna work on that later on. Will y'all give Jazz a hand, y'all? She at least told me. All right, so let me just go on into ministry. Ladies, we are emotional creatures.
Yes.
All right? So not only do we feel things spiritually, but we feel them emotionally.
Yes.
Right? And we have some things that we go through that gentlemen don't have to deal with. All right? Now, get together. See, some of y'all mind, these men, they went somewhere else. Not that part y'all don't have to deal with. This is what I'm talking about. Let me see. Any divorced ladies in here? Mm-hmm. Any single parents?
My Lord.
Mm-hmm. Anybody with financial difficulties?
My Lord.
All calling it. I'm just gonna call, listen, I'm gonna call the whole list. All right, now, some of y'all didn't raise your hand. So, anybody ever been lied on? Ladies, y'all know how, okay. Anybody been talked about? Misused? Mistreated? Listen, I wanna help you today. It's good to be able to call Pastor and have Pastor pray. It's wonderful to be able to call First Lady and have First Lady pray. But I want you to know, you have power. You got your own power, all right? So you are your own anointed woman of God. So I want to do what I can to help you today. Sometimes you have to encourage yourself. Sometimes you have to encourage yourself.
You have the power.
Encourage yourself. Give me his people. Calling on the God who performs miracles. Calling on the God who delivers and saves and sets free. God, today we decree that your people will not leave this place in the manner in which they came. When they leave, oh God, they will leave knowing that you have been touched by the Almighty. God, we bless you and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Before you take your seat, wrap your arms around your neighbor and say, I love you. Service if the Holy Spirit of God can't come in the room. You know, because it would be absolutely useless. You get what I'm saying? Useless. I'm getting all tongue-tied. And the Holy Ghost is so in here on today. But we do greet you today in the name of Jesus the Christ. We do thank the Lord for every opportunity he gives us to go forward and say something on his behalf. I always get excited, Pastor Fred, when I have the opportunity to come into the house of the Lord. You know, because I have been in the battle. I've been on the fire. And I've been in the flood. And if the devil would have had his way, I wouldn't be here talking to you today. But the devil is alive. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, why don't you help me celebrate my friends and your leaders, Pastor Fred Henderson and his lovely wife. So I know that the Father is here, but I didn't come by myself. You know, we come in gangs. When we come from Carrollton, I brought some anointed Holy Ghost filled intercessors and prayer warriors and those that are on fire for Jesus with me. City of Love, holler back at me. It is good to have good friends. I like good friends. He that has a friend must first show himself friendly. Amen. But over and above having a good friend, I like to have a good intercessor with me. I travel with intercessors. I travel with a pack of intercessors everywhere that I go. And they will get together on one accord. I don't even have to call them together to pray. They will pray because God has given them an unction to do so. And they will go in on our behalf, my husband, my children, our entire ministry, and they will bear the devil out. But I love it when they come and say, thus saith the Lord. And I quiet and say, speak, God, and your servant will obey. I mean, you've come to hear a word from the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, well, let me tell you, I submit my life to a man that I call Lester Love. He is my everything. Amen. And I do give God praise, glory, and honor for his life. I am here today because Bishop Lester Love said yes. So can you clap and put your hands together for my husband, my mother? Amen. Y'all too quiet. I'm talking about my mother. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. Amen. And I'm also here to talk to every person that's been in the struggle. Anybody been in a struggle lately? Yeah. Even though you're in the struggle, you've been determined. And that you're not going to let the struggle overwhelm you. Am I talking to the right group of people? Am I in the right house? Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've come with a message that's simply entitled, You Can Pass the Test. You can pass the test. City of Love, you know that we are on tour with this You Can Pass the Test message, because I believe that God is going to heal and deliver and set some people free, because we've been failing far too much. We've been failing test after test, but because God is so gracious, he keeps giving us the test over and over again. Why? Because he loves us and he wants us to pass the test. So can you lay your hand on yourself and say, I can pass. I can pass the test. So don't you quit. Don't give up. Don't change your mind about God, because I stand as God's prophet declaring that you will get through it. I prophesy over your life. You will get through it. Open up your mouth and declare, I will get through it. Say it again like you mean it. I will. Bibles, we are going to James chapter 1, and we'll begin our reading at verse number 2. Elder G is here. Look at that. Look, and she brought Marty with her. I so love them. I love them, Yolanda and Marty. God bless you both. They're so faithful and always supporting what other people are doing. Amen. And because you support others, God's going to take care of you. He said, you'll never forget your labor of love towards his consecrated people. You are on the mind of the Father right now. In Jesus' name, he's releasing. Miracles, opening doors. The portal of God is opening, and his blessings are raining down. Extend your hands towards them and say, God bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. You should be at James 1. Here begins the reading of God's holy word. It says, my brethren, count it all joy. When you fall into various trials, trial after trial. I just came out of something. And now I'm going back into something else. I just finished that. And now I'm dealing with something else. God says, count it all joy. When you go through trial after trial after trial after trial. Why? Because the testing of your faith will produce something great inside of you. The testing of your faith will produce patience. But the Bible says in verse number 4, but let patience have its perfect work. Why? If you allow patience to work inside of you, God says that when patience is finished with you, you will be perfect. You will be complete. And you will want and lack for absolutely nothing. You will be perfect. You will be complete. And you will want and lack for absolutely nothing. Ladies and gentlemen, in this journey called life, we are constantly encountering tests after tests after tests. Life is full of tests. Every day, people of God, the Lord tests us through people. He will test us through pain. And he will test us through problems. So I've come Pastor Fred, to realize that if I see my troubles as a test given to me by the Almighty God, if I see my troubles as a test assigned to me by my Father so that His glory can be revealed in my life, then that means that regardless of the size of the test, regardless of how big the trial is, I can pass the test. Every pop quiz, you're gonna pass if you see it that way. Situation, you will pass sickness and sadness. You will pass the test. It doesn't matter what comes your way. If you see that God has assigned it in order to mature you and do something great inside of you, you will pass the test. Lay hands on your neighbor and say, you will pass the test. Pastor Fran, what is the real purpose of the test? Well, I'm glad you asked. The real purpose of a test is so that when we go through difficult, hard seasons. Anybody been in a hard season? Anybody been in a hard season? When we go through difficult, hard seasons, the Bible says that when your faith is tested, endurance will grow. I'm telling you, God is trying to perfect you. So when you're going through hard seasons, the purpose of hard seasons is so that your faith can be tested. And once your faith is tested, the Bible declares that endurance will grow up in you. The Lord is teaching us today that through test, if we can stand still and see His delivering power, we will pass. The Lord is teaching us today how not to quit, even when times get hard. Why? Because we are going to pass the test, regardless of what the situation is. You got to know that God is in the midst of every situation. And because God is in the midst of every situation, throw back your head and crack open your lips and declare, I will pass the test. So ladies and gentlemen, here we are in the book of James. And James is suggesting, Elder G, that if I don't understand my test, and if I don't fully understand my trials, James is suggesting that if I don't understand the tribulation that I am going through, if I don't learn how to see God in my trials, James is saying that we are going to become a wavering people. We are going to be unstable in our thinking. But I choose to believe that James 1 and Romans 5, I choose to believe that they relate, they come. Their cousins, because Romans 5 says it like this: therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand, and we rejoice in hope for the glory of God. And not only so, we glory, Teresa, in our tribulation. Why? Because we know that tribulation, oh God, I love you, tribulation works patience, and patience works experience, and experience is working hope. And the Bible declares that hope will not make you ashamed. But ladies and gentlemen, I want you to put your attention on the word experience. Let the church say experience. The Greek word experience here means the process or the result of a test. Tests are designed to reveal
student has comprehended. How much do you know from the hard times? What lesson did you learn from all the hell you've been through? What do you know that you can share with somebody else to let them know that you're not going to die, you're not going to die, you're not going to die, but you're going to live and give God the glory? What did you learn from the struggle that you've been in that you are going to be able to share it and give hope to somebody else? Ladies and gentlemen, we understand how to properly go through tests. For the Bible teaches us that tests and trials must be approached with joy. Trials lead to patience, and patience completes us. But Paul declares that we must learn how to glory in tribulation. We got to learn, Lady Kim, how to glory in tribulation. Is that a hard class? That certainly can't be Christianity 101. It cannot be. It must be in the 500s. Because if I got to learn how to glory in my tribulation, that means I have sat at the feet of Jesus for some time. Down in my heart, that means that I got my ear pressed towards heaven, listening for the divine instruction, listening for the divine instruction of the Almighty God. That doesn't just happen, children. It don't just happen like that. You don't just obtain patience like Santa Claus is delivering you something on Christmas morning. Oh, the devil is a liar. If you're going to be patient, baby, you're going to have to work for patience. For tribulation produces, oh God, I love you. It produces patience. So he's suggesting that while we're looking at our life's situations and while I'm looking at this thing that's right in front of me, that's too big for me to swallow, too heavy for me to carry, too difficult for me to understand, while I'm looking at this thing that's right in front of me, he is suggesting that I must praise my God in spite of this overwhelming thing that's right in front of me. He is suggesting that I must praise my God regardless of how uncomfortable I might feel. He is suggesting that I must give my God the glory in the midst of the hell that I'm going through. He is suggesting that I must learn how to say hallelujah with tears running down my face. He is suggesting right, Shauna, coming out of my mouth, but it is the truth. I was diagnosed with breast cancer last July, and if you know anything about cancer, it is malignantly wicked. It metastasizes even when you're not watching it. And so as a result of being diagnosed with breast cancer, I ended up having to have a double mastectomy. My husband was a little concerned about us using the word mastectomy. He said, I don't like that word. I don't like mastectomy. I don't like it. It makes me a little uncomfortable. I said, well, guess what? When I use the word mastectomy, mastectomy is a freeing word for me. It's a freeing word because it removes everything that is not like God. And it causes me to walk in absolute freedom. And it says to me that I'm no longer walking with the enemy. The night before, I had to deal with the most frightening thing I ever dealt with in my life. The night before, my 9-hour surgery, I knew how long it was going to be because they told me. The night before my 9-hour surgery, I said, girl, listen up. You got to get yourself in a better frame of mind. You got to make some adjustments in your mental space. You got to start thinking like God and not like your doctors. You got to start thinking like God and not like the diagnosis. You got to start thinking like God and not like a woman of fear or a woman of faith. I said, okay, God, I choose to think like you. So I went in my closet, brother. Elder G, and I started moving some things around, mother. I threw some shoes out of my closet. I said, get on out of here because I need some space. Not only did I throw some shoes out past the bed, but I threw some clothes out. Some things that I didn't need no more because I was creating some space. Because something was getting ready to happen that was going to change my life forever.
Yeah.
chose to understand this, that God has a purpose for why you are going through the particular thing that you are going through. So my question today is, can you praise God by faith? Says that you have absolutely nothing to praise him for. Can you go through by faith? When your circumstances are totally against you, can you walk by faith and not by sight? When you are faced with something that is going to drown you, can you praise my God even when you can't see him? Enough money to meet your needs. Okay, you have issues, but you have to learn how to see your hope for in while you are in that hellish situation. God gave me a revelation, lady Kim, that has not only changed my life, but it is changing lives everywhere. Learn how to lean. You gotta learn how to lean. What are you talking about, Pastor Fran? You got to learn how to look around that thing that is right in front of you and see your finish in. You got to learn how to lean. Listen, if you won't be in the body of Christ, you won't have to be in shape. You got to learn. Thank you. vision if you can't see it? The Bible says where there is no vision, the people will perish. A vision is a simple manifestation of what is yet to be. So if we lose sight of our future, if we lose sight of what the Lord wants us to be, we will perish. But nobody understood the importance of vision better than Abraham. For the Bible declares that Abraham's human reason for hope was all gone. He had hope in a God that said he would make him the father of many nations. But he was old, and so was his wife. But he had hope in a God who made him a promise that he would give him plenty kids. Plenty, plenty, plenty kids. But what I love so much about this is that in verse 19 it says, as opposed to him looking at his current situation and getting into his current situation, he did not weaken in his faith when he considered the age of his body and the age of his wife's body, but the Bible